But I guarantee you, getting what you came for would not give you satisfaction and fulfillment.
Yes.
Amen? Yes. Why? Because despite the job that you have, despite the money that you have, you're not even happy.
Amen?
Amen. Amen? I'm not saying money does not do anything, but I'm not saying your life satisfaction and fulfillment could not be obtained by having money.
Amen.
Okay, let me ask you, what's your purpose for coming here?
Work.
In church.
Praise the Lord. Worship.
Okay, to praise the Lord, to worship. What else?
To serve the Lord.
To serve the Lord.
To know him better.
Okay, to know him better.
To please him.
Okay. There was a little boy who first attended church, and after attended the church, he was asked, how was it? The boy said, the music was okay, but the commercial was too long. Do you get it?
Yes.
But okay to your praise and worship, but the pastor was too long. He thought the pastor's sermon was the commercial part. Okay, so satisfaction and fulfillment in life come when you have done your kingdom purpose.
Amen.
Do you agree with me?
Amen.
Okay? So our aim for this topic is to resolve in our mind that satisfaction and fulfillment in life is in doing our kingdom purpose. If you are not resolved in your mind about that truth, you will still be confused which one will be your priority. I'm telling you, I'm not denying you, again, I'm not campaigning or I'm not having an advertisement for being an insurance agent, but I'm telling you, my colleagues in the company are earning 70 to 100,000. My manager is earning maybe 100 to 150,000 a year. But especially with my colleague who came here when it was Kian's birthday, he's looking at you as commission, but I'm looking at you as a soul to be served.
Amen.
Thank you. Amen. I could not earn what they're earning because I don't have time to do that. I should have resolved within myself which one is my priority. Are you resolved in yourself which one is your priority?
Amen.
Or where could you get your life satisfaction? Patatahimik niyo. Okay, another aim for this topic is for us to pursue our kingdom purpose. Just to make it clear, before Sister Rica will ask me again, what is the meaning of pursue? To pursue means to follow in an effort to overtake or capture or chase. So if we are pursuing our kingdom purpose, we are really exerting max effort to overtake or to obtain our kingdom purpose. So if you are effortless, mapitex-pitex ka lang, banjing-banjing ka lang, I don't think you are pursuing your kingdom purpose. Because to pursue means to follow in an effort to overtake or capture. Another meaning of pursue is to strive to gain or accomplish. Yes, that I have always made it as an example that there are lots of students in the Philippines who are strivers. During the day, they are working. During the night, they are studying. That's why they are called strivers. Amen.
Amen.
Are you striving to pursue your kingdom purpose?
Amen.
You know that. You and God, yourself and God knows what's going on.
Amen.
Another meaning of to pursue is to proceed along the course of. Nagpatuloy ka. That's why the Bible says, Jesus said, if somebody asks you to walk for a mile, walk with him for 2 miles. And that is so with the kingdom of heaven, with the pursuing God, kingdom purpose, to proceed along the course of. Another meaning of to pursue, to carry further, to advance. Advancement of the kingdom is different from existence of the kingdom. Are you with me?
Amen.
is not enough for the kingdom to exist. It is necessary for it to advance. Just like the church. Yes, God knows how Christian ministry exists, but the question is it advancing?
Amen.
A little bit. Quality-wise, on its way. Music ministry-wise, hallelujah. Thank you very much. As I close my eyes, the feeling that I have is the difference between God Most High Christian Ministry and Hillsong is just the number of people beside
Amen.
You.
Amen.
Music-wise, music ministry-wise, I am boasting. I hope you could keep that on. Baka naman sa sunod na linggo, relax na naman. Are you with me? Okay, another meaning of pursue is to be engaged in. Yes? There are some ladies or gentlemen, they do not engage themselves with anybody else because they said, I'm engaged already. Where are you engaged? In a relationship or in the kingdom purpose? Let's see about that. Okay, so a kingdom purpose, as you are aware, first is to be fruitful. Second is to multiply. Third, to replenish or fill the earth. Fourth, subdue and rule over all the earth. For those who haven't got the idea where did we took that purpose, it was on the text that we're using. Verse 28 of Genesis chapter 1, it says, okay, Then God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth or replenish the earth and subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea or rule over all the earth. At least you know where we took that purpose. Are you with me?
Amen.
I really saw that no matter what our job is, no matter who we are, no matter what is our past, as a citizen of God's kingdom, these are our kingdom purpose. You could not make an excuse, oh, I'm not a pastor, I'm not a choir, I'm just an ordinary member of the church. But I am telling you today, if you claim yourself to be a citizen of the kingdom of God, these are our life's purpose. Maybe you have your own purpose, but if you keep insisting your own purpose, you won't have life satisfaction and fulfillment. Why? Because this is the purpose that God designed us to have. Yes? Okay, Philippians chapter 2, verse 3, let nothing be done through selfish ambition. In other words, when Paul said, let nothing be done through selfish ambition, do not be selfish, okay? The Lord understands you have your own purpose, you have your own goal in life, but He is trying to say, do not forsake the kingdom purpose. Yes? Sad to say, maybe we are concentrating on the kingdom purpose on Sundays for 1 hour or two, but most of the day of our lives, where are we concentrating?
On our job.
That's an honest question or answer. Yes? Verse 4 of Philippians chapter 2, let each of you look out not only for his own interest. Are you with me? So, another translation of Philippians chapter 2, verse 4, when he says, look out not only for his own interest, is for us to be interested in the kingdom purpose, advancement of the kingdom. It is not enough to know our purpose. It is not enough to exist in the church. It is necessary for each and every one of us to be a part to advance the kingdom of God. Amen. I'm so happy to see Treasure today. At least we've got a newcomer. I hope we'll see you again. Okay. We've got kingdom purpose. Yes? When it comes to responsibility, I'm not wondering why your faces look like that. But when it comes to blessing, amen, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Blessing. But when it comes to responsibility, you're so quiet. I hope that quietness signifies you've been touched. Okay? Sad to say, majority of Christians don't know their purpose.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Majority of the Christians don't know their purpose, and for those who knew their purpose, most of them cannot be bothered with it. Hallelujah. Truth hurts, but truth will set us free. How could we advance if we don't care about it, if we could not be bothered about it? Majority of us are complacent. Do you know what's the meaning of complacent? Complacent means contented to a fault, self-satisfied, and unconcerned. Hallelujah. In other words, majority of the Christians who know their purpose could not be bothered. Why? Because they are complacent. They are contented to a fault. They're okay if there's newcomers. They're okay if they haven't achieved anything. They're okay if the church has not been advanced. They're just okay to a fault. They're contented with it. And aside from that, they are self-satisfied. They're okay with themselves. They have heard the word of God. They have been blessed. Their prayers has been answered. They're self-satisfied. That's why they're so complacent. Amen. Christians should not be complacent. We should be having burden within our hearts that you should not be okay with yourselves being saved. We are called for others to be saved.
Amen.
Yes? Okay. Thank you for inviting Trisha today. I'm so blessed. At least with your very young age, you learn to win somebody and invite somebody to church.
Amen.
You're better than me today. I have no invites today. At least I admit I'm not sure with them. Okay, so let's take a closer look upon every purpose. The first purpose was be fruitful, and I call it Christian living. Why? Because in Mark chapter 11, verse 12, those who have been in this church for quite a long time, they should know this already. Mark chapter 11, verse 12, now the next day when they had come out from Bethany, he was hungry, and seeing from afar a fig tree having leaves, he went to see if perhaps he would find something on it. When he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. In other words, Christ is looking for a fruit within us. And what is that fruit? We will learn to obey the will of God. Mark chapter 11, verse 14, in response, Jesus said to it, "Let no one eat fruit from you ever again," and his disciples heard it. Do you know what happened to the fig tree? It withered. John chapter 4, verse 34, Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work." Have you ever come to a point in your spiritual life, in your spiritual journey, that all you can say is, "My food is to do the will of the Father"? Did you understand my question? Okay, I'll give you a short illustration. Do you know that when Jesus said, "I am the bread of life that came from heaven, and who eats me will not get hungry again, will not get thirsty again," and most of his disciples stopped from following him, and he challenged his 12 disciples, "Are you going to stop, or are you going to turn away from me as well?" Peter said and answered Jesus, "Where would we go if we turn away from you? You've got the words that brings us to eternal life." Are you with me?
Amen.
Okay, I'll show you one point. In John chapter 6, what is the main event in John chapter 6? My goodness, they have no idea of what's the main event in John chapter 6. The feeding of 5,000 men, excluding the children and the women. But my point there, Jesus told the crowd, you've been looking for me not because of what I have taught you, not because of my words, but because you have eaten. Because of miracles, because of signs. So Jesus wanted us to seek him not for the bread of life, the temporary bread. That's why in John chapter 6 verse 27 he says, work for food that does not perish, but food that leads us to eternal life. And no other food but Jesus, because he is the bread of life. In other words, we should seek him not because of the food, not because of his provision, because we just wanted him. Amen. He's the true bread of life. He called us so that people will eat the true bread of life. Not just toast, not just English breakfast, not just rice. Are you with me? Okay. Another one is to multiply proper administration. You might be wondering, why did I say proper administration? Okay, to be fruitful is Christian living. Multiply proper administration. To show you my point, Acts chapter 6 verse 1. Now in those days, when the number of disciples was multiplying. Are you with me? Okay, there arose a complaint against the Hebrews by the Hellenists because their widows were neglected in the daily distribution. The context of this in the book of Acts is just like communism. What you own, you give it to the church, and the church will provide according to your needs. Are you with me? There came a problem because a particular group of widows doesn't receive the need that they're supposed to have. So the disciples said, then the 12 summoned the multitude of the disciples and said, it is not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. What's that noise?
Sorry.
Okay? So the disciples said, it is not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. I even come up to a point of thinking, if nobody will cook, why could I be bothered about it? I wanted to cook, but it's not my job to cook. If nobody will cook, we'll not be eating food after the service. That's not a problem. Would you like that?
Amen.
Yung hindi nag-amen, talagang gusto nila may kainan after the service. But my point there, okay, that's not our main concern. My point there is, if I am called to be a pastor, my job is to preach and to study the word. Yes? Do you understand that? It is not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Okay, carry on. Verse 3. Therefore, brethren, seek out from among you 7 men of good reputation. At least, good reputation. Why would you encourage somebody to serve and his reputation is really bad? Yes?
Yes.
Full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. What's the business? Naintindi ba kayo ng English? Bihira naman kayo pag minsan-minsan lang ako mag-English. Are you with me?
Amen.
So what's the business? No. Huh? No. My goodness. To serve tables. Para neighbors and do the business of giving the widows their part of the kingdom. Yes. Pag hindi pa kayo nakaibidin, babatuhin ko na talaga kayo. Verse 4, but we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. So, the main point why there was multiplication of disciples, because the disciples did not leave the word of God and serve tables, but they were continually doing themselves to prayer and ministry of the word. They are so dedicated, they are so devoted in it. Amen? That's why I am not impressed with those servants of God, with those Christians who can give enough time to the Lord. Why? Because they said they continually have prayer and to the ministry of the word. Especially for a pastor like me, most of my time should be consumed with studying and preaching the word of God. I'm not saying Facebook is bad. If I say Facebook is bad, I'm the worst person here. Because babad din ako sa Facebook. But the worst thing is, if you can allocate 1 hour each day of your time to do Facebook and you don't have time for the Word of God, especially if you are serving the Lord, what kind of servant are you?
Lousy
man. Huh? That's why I am not impressed when I say, oh, come on. Let's do the binding. Let's do prayer. And some of you, and I don't have to mention names, but some of you are lousy. When I say let's pray, you should be quick enough to join our hands in prayer. And that's what the disciples did. So there was a multiplication of disciples. Okay, verse 5. And the same pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith. No wonder the Lord used Stephen to do signs and miracles, because Stephen was a man full of faith. I've been reading a book about faith by Miles Monroe. He said, biblical definition of faith, Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, we have faith if we believe on the things we hope for and on the things we cannot see. Simple illustration, he said, even though when you come out from your house and it's sunny, it's so hot, because the weather forecast says it will be raining, what will you do? Okay, you will bring an umbrella, you will anticipate because you believe on the news or the forecast that it would rain. And that is so with asking God, and it is so with our faith, we are anticipating because faith is being sure of the things you are hoping for and of the things you cannot see. Okay, you cannot see the progress, you cannot see the kingdom, but since you are holding on the promises of God, you are working for it, you are anticipating for it, because you are sure of your hope in the Word of God. Amen. Okay, Acts chapter 6, verse 6. Whom they set before the apostles, and when they had prayed, they laid hands on them. Again, in verse 7, then the word of God spread, and the number of the disciples multiplied greatly. In other words, without proper administration, no multiplication will take place. Amen. When I say proper administration, that those who serve tables serve tables, those who sing songs, they prepare their songs properly, they have enough time to do it. Those who are in the prayer intercession ministry, they are praying. That's why proper administration, that's why in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12, God gave, I would like to read Ephesians chapter 4, 4, verse 11 and 12, because this is the purpose of us receiving gifts from the Lord. Verse 11, therefore, oh no, I'm looking on 2:11. Verse 11 of chapter 4, chapter 4 of Ephesians, and he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Are you with me? Yes? Mahinig na naman. Bottom line, for multiplying, everyone does his part and administer his gifts. Yes? I'm going to be honest with you, or I have to be honest with you. I have a difficulty of following up some people who are not attending again, because it seems to me as I'm only one having concern to invite them. Are you with me?
Yes.
Why? There are lots of people who have been attending, but they stop attending, but as if nobody cares.
We care.
Yes?
Yeah. We care.
Okay. Let's put an example. Who care about Mike? Okay. Is Mike just Mike? Am I the only friend of Mike in this church? Who care about Mike? He hasn't attended for how many months already, but nobody knows.
Yeah.
Who texts him, who sent messages to him, or who called him?
I don't have number in Mike.
You're just like the one I knew. Brother Boy stops attending. Who care to call Brother Boy?
He's busy? Yes.
My point there is, if somebody is not attending, it is not just me who got the concern to ring them, to text them, to contact them. If I just know their address, I'm not hesitating to go to their house just to visit them. Are you with me?
Amen.
Okay? Imagine if all of us is concerned, every one of us is doing that. Could you imagine? This hall is too small for us, actually. Yes? Okay? Replenishing, filling the earth, or preaching and teaching. They say, and I believe in it, it is a truth, you cannot give what you don't have. Of course, you cannot give what you don't have. How could you teach, how could you preach if you don't know the Word of God? Yes? Fill the earth with your kind. When the Lord Jesus, when the Lord God, the Father, told Adam and Eve, be fruitful and multiply, replenish the earth, or fill the earth, his main point there is to fill the earth with Christians. Yes? Naalala niyo ba yung example ko sa Pilipinas na one couple, 14 ang kanilang anak?
May
21. Hallelujah. Parang nakano ata yun, naghahabol sa bahay ni Brother Mike. Pag 21 ang anak, bigyan ng house ang lot ni Brother Mike. Ang point ko dito, when David asked, why are you having so many children? They say, because children are blessings from God. Don't you ask why they say that? Because the eldest is selling sampagueta, the second one is selling tubig, second one is selling cigarillo, and that's the blessing. They are helping children to work for them. Ang tatay nagtutuwis, yung nanay nagbabaraha, hallelujah! So, there's no point having many children and they are not Christians. Why? Because when the Lord says, fill the earth, he was trying to say, okay, fill it with your kind. There's no point having lots of population and then they doesn't know the Lord. Especially in India, hallelujah. Do you have idea of what's the population in India? Billion. Philippines nowadays, how many? 100? 120 million. I even heard a pastor who said, there's no point having children today. You know why? Because the population is too much. When the Lord said, fill the earth, because there was only two human beings that time. That's why he said, fill the earth. And now the earth is filled. There's no point having lots of children. Does it make sense? You're so selfish. Palibasa, nakatikim ka na, ayaw mong patikmin tong isa. Okay, so Genesis 1:27, so God created man in his own image, in the image of God, he created him male and female, he created them. What's the relevance of creating them male and female? To multiply or to fill the earth. Why? Because there's no point for a male-to-male marriage or a female-to-female marriage. Whatever they do, they could not multiply. Adam and Steve. Adam and Steve. So God's purpose why we need to get married is for us to multiply. So do not prohibit Ben if she really wanted to get married. Nobody knows.
Yes.
So that she could fulfill God's purpose, her kingdom purpose, to fill the earth. Okay, so we have to take note here that the Ten Commandments were given long way after Genesis 1:28. So what? Speaking up. So what? If there was no Ten Commandments at that time, what's the significance? Okay, all people will be wicked. But when he said, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth, there was no Ten Commandments. Was it necessary at that time?
No.
Don't they need God's commandments when God created Adam and Eve?
No.
No, because their lives was perfectly according to the will of God. Amen. The Ten Commandments were given in Exodus chapter 20 because they were influenced by the lifestyle of Egypt, and before occupying the promised land, the Lord made it sure that they should not be conforming to the lives of those in the promised land. Amen. That's why Sister Portia quote in Facebook today, Romans chapter 12 verse 2, do not be conformed with the systems of this world. But sad to say, we are the ones being influenced by the influences of the world around us. Instead of us influencing them, we are the ones being influenced. Hello? Nagninilay. Okay. Mainam na yung maliwanag. In other words, they were living in accordance to God's will. So there's no point of giving a command. If everybody, as I have said on the last December 4, if everybody is quiet, there's no point me telling you keep quiet because everybody is quiet. Yes? Okay? Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations. Remember, God is not after converts. Hello? He is not happy with converts, but he wanted us to make disciples of all nations. Yes?
Yes.
Carry on. Teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. So for us to teach, for us to share God's word, especially to our own household, we should learn and we should know God's word. When your son or when your daughter comes to you, Dad or Mom, what is meant by this?
I don't know. Let's ask Pastor. He's online in the Facebook. Hallelujah!
So to fill the earth with disciples, not just converts. Subduing and ruling over all the earth, I would say it is praying and fasting. Why? Overcome, or to subdue means to overcome and bring under control. Are you with me?
Amen.
Okay. Luke chapter 9 verse 23, then he said to them all, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself. Let me ask you, who is our first enemy if we desire to follow the Lord?
Satan.
No.
Ourselves. Yeah.
Our first enemy is ourselves. That's why Matthew chapter 16 verse 25, whoever decides to save himself will lose it, but whoever loses his life for the gospel's sake will have it. Amen.
Amen.
Matthew chapter 17 verse 21, however, this kind does not go out except by prayer and fasting. What's the context?
Fasting, prayer.
Context. Committing text. Until now, you don't understand if I say context? My goodness. What's the context? Getting disappointed now. Nagalugin ko pa ba? Ano ba ang eksena dyan? Oh, sige na nga. Ano ba eksena dyan? Bakit sinabi niya, however, this kind does not go except by prayer and fasting. Nagpapahalata kayo hindi nagbabasa ng Biblia? The context was, there was a father whose boy was demon-possessed. He brought it to the disciples, and the disciples could not drive the demon away. So this father brought it to Jesus. And when Jesus rebuked the demon on the child, it go away. So the disciples asked, what happened? Why couldn't we drive the evil spirit away? Jesus said, where is your faith? Oh, you little faith, how long could I stay with you? How long could I mentor you? How long could I keep teaching you? But he said, but this kind will go only with prayer and fasting. In other words, not all prayers could be obtained with just prayer alone. Hello? So, when you don't receive your prayer one way or the other, God is telling you to fast. Imit na naman. Nagmuni-muni. Tama-tama, dumating yung pagkain na fasting tayo mamaya. Yes? Okay. The reason why I say that, in Matthew chapter 16, verse 19, and I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loose in heaven. Have you appreciated what authority you have in Jesus' name?
Amen.
Imagine he said, whatever you bind on earth will be bound where? In heaven. Whatever you lose on earth will be loose in heaven.
Amen.
Are we using that authority to rule over all the earth?
No.
No. Thank you very much. Why? Because you don't know your authority.
Yes. Thank you. That's right.
Thank you. Jake exhorted last night about Paul's example and other disciples. He mentioned that Paul was hardworking and Paul traveled 12,000 miles, usually on a ship or by walking. He traveled 12,000 miles because Paul is hardworking. He forget to mention about Paul. Paul, when he was sent to prison, Paul gave continually the sacrifice of praise and worship. Imagine, you're in prison for preaching the word of God, and then, if you were in Paul's situation, would you not say, "Oh Lord, are you really true? I'm serving you, and then I end up in prison. Hallelujah." But Paul, in despite of his circumstances, he offered sacrifice of praise to God, and then God moved in the midst of the prison cell, and there was an earthquake. Amen. Most of us, if you don't get what you've been praying for, today's the day that the Lord has made. Better stop. It's nonsense. There's a saying, I think it was True Coke propaganda or motto. All or nothing. Is it Coke? All or nothing. Drink Coke or nothing. What I'm trying to say is, give your best shot to praise the Lord or nothing. Why? Because if you're just giving a lousy praise and worship to the Lord, do you think the Lord will be pleased?
No.
Excuse me. Okay. I was meditating on his words about Matthew chapter 6 verse 19. I was thinking, if we prohibit the words of Satan, the words of evil spirits, as according to his word, whatever we bind will in on earth will be bound in heaven. Am I right? But what if those people whom Satan has been working with are inviting Satan, or they are allowing Satan to do their operations in their lives? Let's say, for example, one good example, when I asked my brother, our eldest brother, how's your new year? He said, it's okay except for one thing. My eldest son didn't go home or didn't come home, go away from December 24 until, I'm not sure if it's until now. So their new year wasn't complete. I told him, you should be patient because we could not have all the things all the time. Am I right?
Amen.
God will always give you a problem to make you dependent on Him.
Yes. Amen.
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 Even Moses, as I have told you, Moses was a, what's Tagalog or English of Utan? His son?
Staggering.
Oh, thank you. Utang si Moses. God didn't heal him so that he would remain humble. He would remain dependent to the Lord. And do not wonder why you always have problems, because the Lord wanted you to be humble. Yes? Okay, we go back to this. So I told my brother, we cannot have all the things all the time. He said, it's okay if it's material things, but this one is a person. To cut the story short, we ended up our conversation in fasting. You know, God, what you can do for your son, you should do prayer and fasting. Why? Because when he was praying, it didn't work. That means he needs to fast. Yes, okay. When we were fasting, or he asked me to fast with him so that it will work, if we bind the evil spirit, but the person himself is allowing the evil spirit, would it work?
No.
Let's see. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 7, for the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. Are you still with me? Too much ba? Too much or about? What are you talking about, Pastor? Are you with me?
Yes.
Sa mga hindi nakaintindi or hindi abot? This, the context of this is the Antichrist and the rapture. Verse 7 says, "For the mystery of lawlessness or the Antichrist is already at hand." But he got a problem because he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. This verse is talking about the rapture. So before we will be raptured, our prayer restrained Satan. Yes. Why? Because he said, whatever you bound on earth or bind on earth will be bound in heaven. So you may not be able to see it literally, but your prayer works, it restrains Satan. How could you rule over all the earth if you haven't restrained the enemy? Tahimik na naman. 1 Timothy chapter 3 verse 4. A bishop or a servant of God is a one who rules his own house well, having his children in submission with all reverence. For if a man does not know how to rule his own house, how will he take care of the church of God? I'm praying that the quietness you are showing to me is a deep conviction. So there's no point, or it doesn't make sense a lot, if you cannot rule your own house and you wanted to serve God in the church. How could you rule the church if you cannot rule your own house? Yes. And much worse, how could you rule over all the earth if you yourself, you cannot rule? Remember, our first enemy is ourselves. If anyone decides to follow the Lord, let him deny himself. If you cannot control yourself, if you cannot subdue yourself, how can you rule over all the earth? If you wanted to rule over all the earth, if you wanted the authority of God, you should not only pray, you should pray and fast. Ouch! Parang sinasabi mo, Pastor, ang laki na ng bilbil ko. Ano pa kaya lang sa bilbil? Are you with me?
Amen.
Okay. Bilis ko. Challenge. Are you engaged in advancing your kingdom purpose?
Amen.
Trying to. Are you taking efforts for it?
Yes.
If you say yes, what efforts did you exert to achieve our goal? Okay? At least, saging malilinaw. Kaysa naman, easy get lang. As I have said last Sunday, we are aiming for 100 regular attendees by our 8th anniversary.
Amen.
So supposedly every month we will have 6 new converts.
Amen.
6 times 12, 72 plus our number today, it will make us 100 by January next year. If we cannot win 6 by January, do not expect us by next year we will be 100. 6 by January, 6 by February. Do not expect you can get 12 by February if you don't have 6 by January. Yes? So if you say you're exerting effort, what effort did you have? At least, are you carrying it further to advance the kingdom purpose? Further. That's why I said existence is different from advancement. It's not enough to exist, we should advance. What sacrifice have you got to obtain it? What sacrifice have you got to obtain our goal, to advance the kingdom purpose? Are you striving to accomplish it? It becomes really hard for you. Why? Because if it's not hard, you would not be striving. That's why even the Bible says, strive to enter the kingdom of God. If it's strive to enter the kingdom of God, we should strive to advance the kingdom of God. Conclusion again, Genesis 1:28. Then God blessed them and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. So I invite you to stand up and let us try to put ourselves in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. As I have said, we have all our own purpose. You might not have a kingdom purpose, but at least you have a purpose. You came here to this country to work, to have a greener future, to have a greener life, to have a greener fortune, but the Lord has His purpose for us. That's why we understand here when He said, do not look out for your own interests only. Do not have your own selfish ambitions, but we should live for the kingdom purpose. So Lord God, with your words that we have heard today, please let the message of this song, O Lord, saturate our hearts in your words. Saturate our hearts and minds with purpose, O Lord, so that we could say, we live for this cause, O God.
Thank you.
maaaring hindi ito nagpe-pray ng physical illness mo, pero yung commitment mo sa Lord, nag-heal, nag-use, nagiging stronger, maging, especially yung relationship natin sa Lord, kaya ito tinatawag na healing. So, minsan kasi, na, parang nakasanayan lang natin